said good day, sir!
Welcome everybody here to your coverage of the defense. That's right, the season is back. We're into our fourth season of the defense and we're going shorter, quicker, with just as good teams. And we are going to start today with Na'Vi going up against Mousesports. That's right, we get the boys from Ukraine, the TI1 winners, TI2 second places, and also the new roster really, which has been performing decently well to go up against the winners of the International 3 qualifiers. For the Western qualifiers, it is. That is Mousesports. It's also Syndrome, now captaining the Mousesports team, going up against the old captain. In fact, he's actually in the captain slot right now because Puppy is late today, so he will not be playing in this first game of the best of two matchup. So it's actually Syndrome going up against Kuro on the draft screen. Let's jump ourselves straight into that right now, and I can welcome in my co-commentator for this evening. A lot of people will know him for his very random shout-outs, but he's still here nonetheless for his great insight, and that is Clairvoyance. Welcome to the broadcast, man.
Thanks for having me here, Toby. As usual, we get into this big matchup between Mousesports and Na'Vi, as you have so finely introduced, of course, with Lifestealer being the first pickup, and Mousesports finally getting their hands on the Nature's Prophet that's kind of been getting banned against them, if I recall correctly.
You recall correctly. In fact, the last five games I've cast of Mousesports, the Nature's Prophet has always been the first two bans against them.
Yeah, but knowing Kuroki, I would imagine... He would probably just let some heroes through the pool, and it is a best of two. So yeah, the Shadow Demon does come out now against the Lifestealer, but once again, it is a best of two, so the draft can go anyway in the first game. Mm-hmm. At the same time though, Puppy's not around to pick, so I think they're both gonna go for a very standard in terms of like what they want to just play a standard game out, because if there were pocket strategies, they would probably be used by Puppy.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Like, I think both these teams, like, when you look at the calls of the captains, and Kuro, he's known Puppy for a very, very long time. So the way they look at this is they pick heroes they're comfortable with, heroes which they know are stable, and they just basically go. Like, both these captains are very, very standard-style captains. Puppy himself, like, everything which he does, like, sometimes it's just a logical way of looking at it. So that's why I think Syndra and Puppy's logic, like, sometimes they don't really mesh up together quite well, hence TobiWan was always an interesting time. But most of the time, it's very predictable what they're going to go. Because you look at Mousesports right now, they get SD, they get Prophet, they get Animage. It's all the heroes they're very comfortable with. And then you look at Na'Vi, and you've got Lifestealer, Storm Spirit, Nyx Assassin. Dendi loves his Storm Spirit. Lifestealer is a standard hero for them as well as the Nyx support. Everything is just comfortable in this first game.
Yep, it does look very standard in that regard. Alchemist as well as the Magnus getting banned. Not too many big surprises there. I'm kind of wondering why Na'Vi would decide to take out Ouch. I guess the other day they had a little bit of a kerfuffle against it, you know, where they kind of started ramming their heads into pretty much like a steel wall because they just couldn't break the base of Fnatic. Mm-hmm. And they came through at the end, of course, but regardless, that hero is very, very powerful. Though I'm not too sure if Mousesports would have tried to utilize that against the Lifestealer and Nyx Assassin as a support. I know they love their Alchemist as support because they think the Concussion is really good because it does physical damage, right? So it always goes through the Lifestealer's Rage. Mm-hmm. And yeah, and because it's a charge-up, you can kind of just mess around with the Nyx Assassin's Carapace. You can wait it out or try to hit him before and all that kind of tricky, neat details. So with that said, you know, the Puck is getting banned out against them. So I think they want to secure a safe, easy mid lane for the Storm Spirit right now.
Yeah, well, right now, like, the Puck would be the main man who would cause trouble for Storm Spirit. You need to have a silence to lock down Storm Spirit. So it almost forces Mousesports to go down that Queen of Pain Orchid kind of line, if that's what they want to run, unless they feel they can get control in another manner, but it still requires them to have something which lines up nicely against Storm Spirit, and also have support heroes that can roam and gank the Storm Spirit before he hits level 6. I was casting a game last night with the Capitalist, and one thing we're noticing when the Storm Spirit was being played, he wasn't touched till level 6, and then he was just able to move himself anywhere on the map and be so active, anything you want to do, because he was never shut down the very, very start. So the money just kept rolling in, and you just keep going with the punches. And Skywrath Mage will be the pickup here from Mousesports here in the fourth one.
That's literally pretty much the perfect pickup in this scenario. My qualm against both Queen and Skywrath is just the fact that, pardon me, Na'Vi already have the specific counters for a lot of anti-hero roles as well as squishies. Now, you know, with the Nyx Assassin's heavy amount of burst damage, as well as Storm Spirit's ability to just jump in with the Lifestealer Bomb, there's not many heroes that are going to stay alive when they get caught in this scenario, especially not a Skywrath and even Anti-Mage. But at the same time, with a Queen of Pain, it's actually a very old-school strategy where Anti-Mage was top pick every single game. And if you pick Queen as well as AM, you have two blinkers that can go around the map non-stop and kind of just put map pressure every single location and get out safely every single time, because they can always prevent an engagement from happening just by getting away 1200 range instantly. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's kind of fallen off. And in this scenario, I think Skywrath is better because you're not really lacking in mobility on Mousesports lineup right now. They have the Anti-Mage and Nature's Prophet, as well as one last pickup that can still be a potential long laner. And Skywrath is definitely one of the best candidates to shut down a hero like Storm Spirit at mid. His harass potential is kind of unparalleled in the current version. Not to mention the fact that his instant cast silence, target silence, man, that thing, it changes games very, very quickly. So very good against Lifestealer, very good against Storm Spirit.
I like the pickup too, man. Just a reminder out there for everyone who is tuning in. If you are watching on the live stream, greetings and welcome to everyone over on the TobiWan.DOTA live stream. This is, of course, where you'll find all the matches from the defense being broadcast out. If you're also watching in through Dota TV right now, congratulations, you managed to find the game. The Dota TV ticket will start to sort it all out, and that should come on the patch on Thursday, and that'll also come with that little bit of a like the bonus that comes. It's kind of a two-for-one-er with the ticket that's on their way, so you'll enjoy that one. I'm going to enjoy this one. I'm going to enjoy this thing so much, man. It's been a while since I got to cast Phonic playing Clinks. It's been a while, and this is aggressive trialing now. So Rubick Nyx Lifesteal to go top, because they already the Bane was already banned out, and Storm Spirit for the mid, and that's going to be Clinks on a long lane. I mean, on the safe lane for him.
You know, I may be mistaken, but I think I just saw that about within the span of last week, actually, where Na'Vi tried to play it against EG.
Mm-hmm.
It might have been an East thing, but there was a Nature's Prophet. Yeah, Bamboo against Funnik on Bamboo's long lane, Funnik's safe lane with Clinks versus Nature's Prophet. And he held his ground. It was an even matchup. If you understand that matchup, I feel like with the treant, you can do a lot of things because Clinks is a lot more squishy than he looks. And with that Beastmaster pickup, now, it looks like it's going to be a mid lane Beastmaster for Feyda and a support Skywrath Mage. So either way, it works. Beastmaster is used to push the lane against Storm Spirit, and you can get the rune control that way. Mm-hmm. And of course, Beastmaster is not always the easiest hero gank because his strength, his stack gain is really good. Very high movement speed from base, as well as his armor. But yeah, just going back onto the Clinks point, this Clinks is going to have to snowball really fast because he's going to fall out later on.
Oh, most definitely. But that's what Funnik does so well with his Clinks play. I remember when he was back in the days of Team Empire. In Team Empire, their big rise to fame when Funnik was with them, it always came with this three-man aggressive lane and this solo Clinks that just got so much farm it wasn't funny. I am interested, though, to see where Dendi is moving right now because it looks like he's considering going safe lane. I'm guessing this is just to move out to the jungle, though, because the lanes should be aggressive on the top. But if that was also going to be the case, they'll be moving up as five and putting down wards. But Na'Vi aren't doing such a thing. I think this might actually be a long lane Clinks if this is the case. Or, yeah, he's built for solo mid almost.
Yeah, he's pulled. Funnik is going a standard pool build where Kuroki gave him pretty much two pieces of regen. Actually, no, he only got one piece of regen. Regardless, instead of even without branches, he's probably going to take up the solo lane, safe lane role. I mean, Storm Spirit is just not, especially against the Beastmaster, you need something that can kind of damage the creeps. You know what I mean? And because that inner Beast aura is going to kick in, and it's going to constantly push the lane, whether you like it or not. And that means you lose rune control guaranteed, unless you decide to sacrifice experience. In which case, your mid lane is no longer being efficient because you're losing out one of the two more important things at the lane. And Storm Spirit can maintain lane control with his harass ability from his remnants.
Mm-hmm. There's a little bit of banter going back and forth between both Na'Vi as well as Mousesports. Luckily, our resident admins are racially German, so they understand what these guys are talking about. That is, in fact, German, if you're wondering what it's about. And Feyda was just trolling a little bit, saying you're putting in that much effort to try and kill off a treant. I hope the five experience is worth it for everyone that has it. So
he's calling... He's calling Na'Vi tryhards right now.
Oh, most definitely. Most definitely. But there's also Bandit going out. These guys are actually really, like, decent friends. Like, because obviously, like, Kuro stayed friends with all the guys in Mousesports, so there's no real bad blood here. He's going up against his old team, most definitely, but no one's gonna be like, ah, Kuro, we hate you. Oh, Syndrome, this is a nice Droon to have. Hey, it's Droon already. He's just trying to push Dendi off the lane so he can't just stay on the front lines and farm up, but then he's still not stopping his CS. Okay, I stopped that one, but he's still got 2-0 here in the middle lane.
Yep. The bigger implication with that is that Feira, yeah, he's being very smart. He moved away to dodge the creep wave so Dendi's creeps don't go straight into the tower. Unfortunately, that effort's a little bit diminished now that it's going in, but regardless, the lane is still on his side of the map, you know what I mean? And Storm Spirits, especially at level 1, he's playing really, really up on Feira because there are no stuns involved. Mm-hmm. But if there were stuns and burst damage involved, Storm Spirit would have to definitely sit back.
Yeah. But you know, if you can be aggressive, you may as well do it. Just want to also let people know what's at stake for this one, because I didn't really take a lot of time to explain the format of the defense. For those guys that read the news articles about it over on joindota.com, then you'll understand what's going on. But for people that don't, the group stages will be played out over the course of basically 2 weeks. It's not going to run much longer than that. There's a couple of postponed days we have, just in case. This might have to wait a second for this one. It's a Vorse. Ah, he's too slow. He's too slow to get in there onto the Beastmaster. But they smoked up to try and give that one a shot. But yeah, the way the group stages work is all teams will play a best of two for their matches in their group stages. The number one team will go straight into the upper bracket of the playoffs. That's where the top teams go. Then we actually eliminate two teams from each group stage, I believe it is, and then the rest of them go into the lower bracket. So basically, losing a game is really, really bad in this group stage. You lose one game, oh, Den, he's going to be annoyed about this one. Salve being cancelled, and Syndrome coming in with a DD rune. Yeah, she has a lot of damage with Axe combined. Den, he could be in a lot of trouble right now. The boar slowing him down. Vader got that one hit off from the boar. Prophet's going to TP in, and they got enough damage. Axe to fly, and the first blood goes to Vader. Now Sports, they spill it.
Syndrome is playing really, really well here. The fact that he's able to just walk into the lane without smokes put so much pressure with a hero like Skywrath only at level 2 it's pretty incredible to watch, because he does have the double damage, and granted, of course, without the securing of that rune, he wouldn't have gotten the kill. But at the same time, just one concussive shot as well as a couple arcane bolts, he's able to do enough damage for the storm to set up a kill for his Beastmaster, who's going to bottle crow now with his boots up, because I believe he's got the first blood. Yeah, he's got boots coming out, and this is not going to look good for Dendi.
No, this is a horrible position for him to be in, and that rotation from mid lane really had to work. And as you kind of put it down to warding right now for Na'Vi, because Syndrome could walk himself in because there's no vision for Na'Vi watching that top rune, which is very, very surprising when you think about it, because like Na'Vi have all their extra supporters just pulling through on the bottom lane. They're controlling the CS. They're just farming up Funny down here on the bottom lane. He's having a great time. Goes to Ring of Aquila. Got the double Sage's Mask up too. So this Orchid's going to come at a really fast rate for him. But at the same time, like, there's no support coming the way of Dendi. He's very, very exposed here in the middle lane. They might just be hoping he gets to level 6 before that gank would come. And I would really be looking for Mousesports to gank a secondary time before Dendi does hit that level 6. Rord's going to come up around the same time as Dendi could make it. But SD, he's not really the best hero to try and lock down that Storm Spirit.
No.
Skywrath may be having... Yeah, and here we go again. There's no smoke that's going to walk themselves in. And again, at the same time, both Kuro and Dexter come into this middle lane. They're looking to help him out. I think Kuro's also realized the problem. He's come up here with Observer Wards, and now it's going to be Dexter. Concussive shot, slowing him down. Cinderin stays in the back of him. He's got another rune. It's the Haste rune this time around, so that's 3-for-3 for Mousesports. And just force him back in range of the tower.
Interesting engagement. I feel like they could have probably engaged Kuroki there. And I say that because when Kuroki was out just above the Dire Ward, he didn't see them. But because the Dire Ward was there, they were able to see him. Mousesports, of course. Kuroki coming down the mid lane hill, walking into the river, getting himself right in between the mid lane as well as the rune. They had a Haste rune, they had a Shadow Demon. All they needed to do was put him under Beastmaster nuke with Skywrath nuke, and Kuroki would have died for sure. So I feel like that was a little bit of a missed opportunity coming out of them. But regardless, there were no casualties, so everything's still okay.
Alright, Dendi wants to be a little bit more aggressive here on Feira. Now the boar comes up and Dendi won't be able to keep up, or does he really want to? No, he doesn't have enough mana left. The bottle will arrive now, so he does have some more mana. And Feira, it's a good time for his bottle to come in as well. Still gonna be 0-for-1 here, and Dendi, he's... He's not baiting out that Null Talisman. He's dropping it so he can get more mana back in again faster. But he should still be very, very careful when there's a boar on the field.
Yeah. Very neat trick would be using the boar to kill the item. And with that said, Dendi is still doing so much better than Feira at the mid lane. Once again, this is partly due to the fact that Dendi, he's spamming his Static Remnant, and he's using his Overload to harass the Beastmaster. Of course, a ranged hero versus a melee hero, most of the time the ranged hero will win the harassment exchange. But when you get the first blood, you get your skills appropriate to the lane, and you can just snowball it and just make the advantage into something bigger than they had expected to be. And you know what? He's dead right here. Storm Spirit's level 6, he's gonna pull him out, and there goes the Vulse.
Yeah, open wounds. Oh. War Dexter gonna blow the stun, but he still throws out the Mana Burn to get it. The Vulse got a little bit of extra damage, so Prophet hitting level 6 inside the jungle, only just hitting that at the time as well.
Yep.
But that's the third attempt now to gank up the middle lane. It's the first time it's successful.
It's okay though, because the second time it was actually the rotation of Mousesports supports that were able to shut it down. But now we look at the game and Dendi's level 6, Toby. He's bottle crowing, he's got half his mana pool, he's ready to go for round 2 very, 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 very soon.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that Feira still doesn't have Inner Beast means he can't push out the lane as much as he'd want to. Which means that now that wards are down 6 minutes into the game, unless support rotation happens, it's the tables have turned. Feira is the one on the back foot now, and he's gonna be careful.
Yeah, that he does, man. But at the same time, we've kind of forgotten about a lot of the lanes, mainly top and bottom,
yeah,
where Black. We just saw like Black just took the tower on the top lane. Funnick as well has managed to add enough pressure to the bottom lane. The T1 tower has gone down as well there. But if you check out Funnick's farm, he's already sitting on one of his Oblivion staffs. Curry doesn't have any more parts of it, but he's one Oblivion staff into that Orchid. And you look at Black's farm, and Black's sitting there, and he's still the, we're looking at a broadsword as well as his Void Stone to come up, and then he will be at that point of having the Battle Fury. But at the same time, you've got to remember what's going to be more important. Like, we've got Nake's Bomb timing that's going to be coming off with the combination of Avorst and Dendi. And they're going to be looking to kill off everybody, and that's going to come around the same timing as Klinks will have his Orchid up and running. So around that like 12-minute mark is where I'm probably going to say it, because, and again, with the free farm on the bottom lane, Funnick can probably do it in 11. He'll have that Orchid, maybe even sooner. He'll have that Orchid up and running, and then they just go. Nakes has level 6, Storm Spirit has level 7. It's just going to be gank central, and I'm wondering if Mousesports is going to be ready for it, and if they can make enough space without having to bring in Black. If Black can continue to farm up, it might be different. Syndrome picked up and thrown back. Dexter, follow up on the stun. Mana Burn as well. Syndrome taking a lot of damage, and there's the Fey Bolt. Kuro ensures the kill with a level 3 nuke.
With the next Assassin, definitely enough damage to take the Skywrath down. But one really important points that you noted out, very concisely too, rather, is that, yeah, it's really entirely up to Mousesports and pretty much on Koifa as well as Feira to make enough space, because every time I see an anti-mage and a Klinks counter specifically with a lifestealer on the Klinks' team.
Storm, oh, pardon me, there's your next bomb right on the Fader in the middle lane. He's still got Roar. Disruption from Pass will buy him some space, and now Syndra, he wants to go on a Vorse. The Roar will go out in him as well. They ensure the kill. Fade Bolt by Kuro actually brought himself in way too close. Water Talk and Ether Stun, but Blink down by Black. He wants to be in this fight. All 5 players from Mousesports assemble quickly and very effectively in the middle lane.
Yeah, they're going to go for the mid tower here. And of course, with 5 heroes as well as the Beastmaster in the fray, of course, there is no Inner Beast. But regardless, the presence of 5 heroes as well as Treants, they're taking this tower for sure, Toby. Navi, they're not even going to try to contest it. Funnick's probably going to go by a TP scroll.
Kuro's TPing in on this one. He actually finished that. Got silenced instantly. He never got the telekinesis off and just loses his life instantly. Pass cops a lot of damage from the tower, but the aggro is taken away. And a very hopeful slash suicidal TP in from Kuro.
Yeah, they're definitely very suicidal. I'm not sure what he was thinking there. But Anti-Mage, you're walking a little bit too far, buddy.
Yep, now Black. He's still got the open wounds on him, but with a Blink, he can just move so damn fast so quickly that there's no real way for Na'Vi to chase until Denny's got a higher mana pool.
Right. But that fight was a very, very good tell of all the things that were going to happen, I feel like, because now that Klinks is about to finish his Orchid, he's going to begin his rotations. And when a Klinks begins rotations against Nature's Prophets and Anti-Mages, they're high bounty kills. Not so much because they give gold, but because they're the enemy carries. And at this point in the game, if a Klinks is able to cancel out Anti-Mage, in the 4v4 game, Na'Vi have the better damage, they have the better burst, and they have the better course to fight. Of course, this is once again speaking without the Anti-Mage, because when an AM rushes Battle Fury, he doesn't have survivability against an Orchid Klynx who's going to hunt him down. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, if Na'Vi get baited into situations like what they just did at the mid lane, with Dendi spending most of his mana pool to dive one hero at nighttime without vision, they're going to get turned on, they're going to lose towers, and eventually they're setting themselves up for a bad game of base defense.
Yep.
So Na'Vi have to be really, really careful. Efficient rotations coming out with smokes is recommended. And of course, with the Nyx Assassin in the fray, I feel like... Oh, you know what? I just checked this Nyx's level. He's level 4. He needs his level 6 for more things to happen around the map.
Yeah. He's almost been the sacrifice as far as all the supports go. Same with Cinderin. Like, Cinderin, he's walking around level 4. That's the reason why we're seeing him, like, start to double stack. He'll look for some farm. They're both, like, we've got 6-3, 4-2 as far as the CS goes. Where SD as well as Rubick, they've managed to find their levels. Now the Kuro has level 6. He only just picked that up. And he's already buying up wards and smoke. So Kuro wants to try and make something happen. Nakes has Infest off cooldown, and yeah, this is actually a really old strat that's coming off from Na'Vi. That's actually one of the original things they tried when they first created this team, by having the Nakes not as like this long lane sacrifice, but just starting in the jungle and combining him with a jump hero in the mid. It's really old school for them. I love even like still using their hand and Midas to kill off the Hawk.
Nice play.
Easy money, man. Easy money.
It's too bad the Hawk itself doesn't give too much EXP, so Midas wasn't too efficient. But regardless, he's a melee hero. He's shutting down vision. Can't really complain.
Yeah.
Let's just see if there are going to be more complaints coming up, because as I see it, Funnik is rotating to the top. He knows if they don't put pressure on Black, and mind you, Black has not been getting any pressure at all. This guy is sitting at 93 CS, a good majority of that.
Oh, he found pass. He found pass. That's a free kill, but he doesn't know the supports around it.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think he would have gotten it, because Paz would have probably walked out of vision. Nah, he would have getting.
This is the one he wants. I don't know if Koifa saw it. The pings came out from Black, and Koifa didn't budge. Scepter.
He has a gold scepter.
Wow, already?
Yeah. Man, these rotations coming out of Na'Vi, they're looking worse by the time, because now Havos, he's just got his Midas, but yeah, with the gold scepter up on Nature's Prophet, he's going to be that much harder to kill. And once again, Funnik, he's wasting a lot of time right now. He lost his entire death pack, so he's probably got to go back. He's going to resume farming. But what is he going to get? What items is he going to farm on the Klynx right now that can help refute this situation? Because right now, Na'Vi, they need towers, they need map vision, they need map control.
Normally Funnik on his Klynx will be looking at BKB and Crystallis. That'll be the first set of items.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way he would normally look at it.
Will that be enough against Mousesports lineup, though?
Against this one, I think it's enough if... The problem is going to be the heroes he's looking to pick off. He needs to find that momentum. He wants the Nature's Prophet. That's the bigger one he wants. That's the reason why he came here. He knows Nature's Prophet's been free farming to a point that he actually has a Ghost Scepter. That's not cool. But he's going to have to go for someone else. Someone who doesn't have an escape. And that's Fader. And he's found him too. So, goes up. Orchid also body blocks. Getting a little bit of an over jump there. Can hold Fader in position long enough. And the Orchid will pop him. So, Klynx gets the one kill he's looking for. And these kills have to keep coming. At the same time, though, Lifestealer goes down on the top lane. So, SD plus Pass and Koifa now TP's himself in. They're going to have pressure this tier 2 tower. So, there's already revenge.
Yeah, that was very worth it. You know that whole engagement? As soon as Beta saw them with the Hawk, you saw him running down straight to the mid T1. I was wondering why the Shadow Demon was not TPing, because I know Paz is, you know, he TP'd out earlier, but he also has a TP scroll, and he just didn't TP. And then, yeah, after I realized they were killing the Lifestealer for the Anti-Magian, that's actually worth it. So, well done by Mousesports, once again, doing a lot of damage to the Tier 2 top tower. Looks like it's about to get denied.
Yeah, they'll deny it. 23 HP, there's no way they wouldn't deny it. I also like this preparation from Mousesports. Observer and Sentry sitting back.
Cinderin.
Where's Cinderin? What's that? It's got... Wow, Klynx found him. I was about to like applaud the vision play of Mousesports. They saw the Invis coming, but yeah, wrong area of the map.
Mm-hmm. He pretty much got 100-0, so it's okay. He died really, really quickly. And of course, once again, Skywrath Mage, not the most tankiest hero. You know, he's got one armor at level 5, and speaking of which, he's level 5, so... Normally, level 5 heroes, normally, they kind of drop pretty fast.
Even Pass will drop pretty fast, because he built into Arcane Boost, he doesn't have an urn, he's building up a whole lot of wards, so... Either way you look at it, both these supports are basically food for Mousesports. They have to walk next to one of the cores, no matter what happens here.
Mm-hmm.
They have to walk next to him. Fader at least has the mech that might be able to help him out. We also noticed too the item build of Storm Spirit, because I thought we might just go full out silence. No, he goes into BKB. So he's picked up the Mithril Hammer, he's a recipe away. Nyx does have his level 6, so they might look to initiate here. Koro probably still willing to steal another ability, while Fnatic is hunting on that top lane, and he finds Black. I don't really know if he really wants to kill off Black, but he might feel the power to do so.
That's going to be a very tricky one. I'm actually
Dendy's rotating curious. Top lane to help him out, but by doing so, he's walking past two Observer Wards of Mousesports. So Black, it's got to be very obvious. In fact, Syndra's already pinging the T1 tower. Storm, long jump, and the Orchid. Black will pop from this. There is no doubt. Maybe there is a doubt. Pass comes in with a disruption. Black blinks himself away. Fantastic timing to TP in. Now Fader, no mana for Aurora. He's bottling up as fast as he can. Now the Roar does go. It goes on Dendy, who's completely out of mana. Koifa will TP in. AM even throws the ulti to ensure sure the kill. Havos locked in, and he will also take a fall. It's a double kill for the Beastmaster, and support rotated in from Na'Vi, and Kuro's like, screw it, let's give this a shot. I still want Black, but Fader's now in here. AM pops the ulti. He did not really pop that before again? Really? Okay. Then over to Dexter. Spy Carapace, nice one. He's actually gonna get the kill on Black before he goes down, but it's still a triple kill for the Beastmaster.
Wow. Yeah, that ultimate was coming out of the Rubick. Kuroki stole it. Very nice timing, of course. Kuroki stealing spells, nothing new. What's interesting, though, is that that whole fight, once again, Na'Vi played that perfectly. They were in ward vision. Black was in mid-blink animation.
Oh, Funic.
Uh-oh, Funic.
Easy snipe. Very, very easy snipe off.
Yeah.
And that's what we talked about. The supports need to walk next to a core. That's why Cinderin's also just TPing out just then.
Right. He's got 1k gold in his inventory now. Let's see what he buys. I think it's going to be an Arcane Boots, but I really feel like in this kind of game, he should just go for a Treads. Regardless, the nice kill that came out of Na'Vi was Dexter. He walked in. He's a stand-in, so he's kind of probably hesitating between the team, like what he should do when that scenario happened. He walked in, he was able to find the AM, and he killed him. Black actually attacked Dexter when he was in Spike Carapace form, and he got himself stunned. So a little bit of misplay coming out of Black, but at the same time, very good kill for Na'Vi, and a very well-needed one, because Toby, we got a fine example just now of how powerful the counter rotation is. Oh, pardon me, Storm.
The second Dendy saw that, he jumped so quickly. And now Avos is the one that's in trouble. Rage is up, the Roar is still going to go, so there's no extra damage from that one. But Syndra can throw the concussive shot. He's going to infest the boar. A little bit of lack of micro there from Fader. He gave him an out. The problem is, though, that boar is in control of Mousesports. So he jumped out of it and will now start running again. He's going to rage his concussive shot out, which he will do so.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to be okay.
He will be. But for 18 minutes into the game with a 6-7 minute hand of Midas, Kobos is not doing very well in farm. He's only level 10. He's one of the core heroes that really need to dish out the damage. And granted, Lifestealer innately does a lot of damage, so it's fine as far as timing goes for now. But It's going to kick in very, very quickly when Black gets his Manta style, that this Lifestealer is just going to become a no factor against the anti-mage specifically. Of course, he can still snipe supports, but Funic can do that very well by himself already.
Funic's so about not, to snipe another one. Pass too far out, which means Funic just open up on him. Yep, there we go. 3 hits, 4 hits, and he gets the kill. Doesn't have Invis straight away, but he's got a lot of damage he can dish out to Black, especially as he's just carrying this casual Mithril Hammer up on him, and he is going to go his normal build. So we're going to go Orca BKB after the Ring of Aquila.
Ah. Yeah, that's good to see. He's going to need to stay alive as long as possible. He already does enough damage, and as we saw, Black, you know, he right-clicked Funic once after blinking, and he said, nope, this is not happening, so he decided to back. Is he going to get sniped again? Dendy's here looking for a kill. He drops
Static
a remnant. He has flying vision. Oh, my.
He got roared before he could fly himself out of here. Dendy also silenced up, which means he's going nowhere. Syndra very timely on that Skywrath Mage.
Man, that Ancient Seal, if you ever played against the Skywrath with a Storm Spirit, it's just, it's not a fun experience. And needless to say, no fun for Dendy.
I don't want more no fun heroes, but Skywrath Mage actually makes fun. He makes ganking. He shuts down the no fun heroes.
Oh, no doubt about that. But it's just sometimes, you know, when you have like, say you're playing Storm Spirit and you play here against heroes like Skywrath or Nyx Assassin, and then you realize that there's virtually not much you can do against these heroes other than just stay back and wait for them to finish using their spells. In which case, that means you have to just, yeah, you're playing on your back foot, and it's always no bueno to play on your back foot a lot of times, especially for pivot players like Dendy, who like to walk around the map and who like to get something done.
Funic, this is a really good movement right now. Vendetta, there's no sentry walls, there's no nothing.
Shadow Blade.
Yeah, but he's got to actually stun him. Oh, there it goes. They got no invis detection. Storm Spirit will jump up, and he's actually looking to chase down. There's a sentry ward, so they can see Koifa, but they won't pass. Open wounds to go off. There's a secondary sentry ward now being thrown down. That one was by the Dire side, so it got instantly dewarded. Sprout in the wrong position, looked to actually catch out a Vort. Now Black, the Orc is still on cooldown for another 7 seconds. And Syndrome throws out the stun while Nyx Assassin, Spy Carapace got up in time. Now they open up on Black. Big ult from the Skywrath Mage. Takes so much life points from a Vort. He couldn't infest. He tried to reach for the boar, but he couldn't get inside him. Not in time. If he did, he could have just popped out and killed Black off. So it ends up being a 2-for-1 trade.
Yeah, that was a really close call for Black. The Orchid was really nice on him. He almost died to the Orchid tick, actually, as he was retreating. But that mech from Feta, very, very timely. Very clutch save, rather. And Mousesports coming out again, ahead on the exchange. And
Cinderin.
What they were doing on the defense. Oh, pardon me, Fate. Cinderin going
hits.
Down here.
I don't know if that's going to be enough to pop him, man. No, he's on 131 and already TPing out of here. Same with Koitfa. But Funic at least stops the pressure going onto the tier 1 tower from them. And then up on the top lane, Kuro's playing around with Black, and he just stole 4 points blink. Best ability a Rubik can have.
Oh man, it makes your Rubik so much more fun. Oh!
Alright,
Koki.
He's playing mind games, but Black should know what this is like. Black played with Kuro for a very, very long time. He knows exactly how Kuro ticks. And all Kuro was trying to do then was just show who's the bigger man.
Yeah,
this is a solo Rubik up against an anti-mage. Anti-mage who's level 14, and anti-mage blinks from a level 9 Rubik. That's the mind games, man.
Most certainly is, and it's always very, very good to see that coming out of the... well, they lead to big plays later on, of course, but very nice to see it coming out of these players. Kuroki's drawing on the map. He's circling that the anti-mage is farming, and he needs to gank. That's what they're saying between Na'Vi right now. They know that they have to gank this anti-mage. Once again, like, we keep seeing in these engagements where Funny's able to pick off support heroes. That's great. But the question is, are you getting towers? Are you getting map control? Are you able to take Roshan or perhaps even stop the imminent Roshan attempt that's going to happen sometime after a team wipe? And Funic with the double damage, he's questioning himself about it. And he's looking to make a move. But he's also scared because he knows the supports as well as the spells coming out of Mousesports, they can lock him down very well.
With his BKB, he'll have the confidence to do it. He's got two heroes here to go on. So he starts off and he's going to get rolled up. He's still inside the BKB though. So he can jump back into Invis, get away from the tower, and then Fader. Well, actually the Nyx coming in through the side, looking for the stun. Skywrath ulti, that's a lot of damage on a Dexter. That was just a commitment to try and save the Klinks. But with him down now, are Mousesports thinking about? I think they are. They're going to go in for Roshan.
Yeah, with the Beastmaster as well as the Prophet Trees, it's going to happen. And this is just like... just been mentioned about a couple minutes ago is that, yeah, this Rosh attempt. What are they going to do with the heroes?
Storm
they're gonna dive
jumps
in.
Then he wants to have a crack at this one. He pops off the dust so we can see Koitfa. It looks to be the one he wants to target. Nake's already popped himself out, so they kill Cinderin over on the left-hand side of the screen. Fader might be the next one to go down. It's a lot of damage by Klinks, but not enough to finish it off. Now Black comes in, and Funic, he's got to go Invis. Black pops the ulti, he kills him off. Havos was really thinking about going in for Roshan. He can't finish that just yet. He's out of Infest as well. Already used when they jumped in. So he's armor toggling out this, but Koitfa right behind him. He's looking for the right time to attack him, and there goes the rage. He's got to armor toggle this perfectly. Black picked up by Koro. He will go down. Avos does take a fall at the same time. And then over towards Danny. Axes to fly. Decent nukage. Koro not looking too healthy, but he can blink himself away to safety. After Mecha's popped off, but there's extra TP support coming in. Cinder into the tier 2 tower, and Koitfa, one hit out of the Shadow Blade. That's more than enough damage to kill him off. And Dexter, now I realize he's in range of a Sentry Ward of the Dire side. So has to retreat himself out, can't go in there to contest up Roshan. He's the only one left alive for Na'Vi.
Yeah, the mind game's coming out once again. It played a role there because, you know, you saw as Havos was getting chased up the hill, Black was going back and forth, looking to blink. And of course, Dendi, him being low himself, wanted to stay around and maximize his efficiency. So he was also going back and forth. And in the end, when Black blinked in, they caught him. But at the same time, at what cost is my question? Because Na'Vi, they lost 3 heroes in the process. Kuroki got picked off, and Lifestealer as well as the Storm Spirit, they certainly didn't make it out alive in that engagement.
Mm-hmm.
And now Mousesports, they're infinitely ahead. I know the gold graphs and stuff, the numbers are not too indicative because, to be honest, 5k is not, it's negligible. 24 minutes into the game against an anti-mage. But at the same time, if you consider the fact that this AM now is unkillable because he has a Manta style, he's not going to get locked down by any single target spells.
Mm-hmm.
And also the fact that this Aegis is up and running, as well as an Aghanim Scepter on Feta. We know Toby now with Shadow Demon and Beastmaster, the counter initiations can happen. They just went on a completely different level.
Man, Mousesports, man, even their like initiation is going to be so great. They got an Aghanim Scepter up on a Beastmaster 25 minutes into a game. He's looking so good right now. Feta walking around the Invis, smoke breaks. They realize someone else is around here. And he just goes back up to the tier 1 tower, and the Hawk is watching all of Na'Vi move. Syndra also caught a glimpse. I've actually been really surprised at how defensive Funnik has been during this game. Like, he saw Syndra for a very, like, a short moment, and he could have just, like, turned and killed him off. But he doesn't know what support's coming. He's really fearful, I think, of seeing an Aegis Prophet come in with a Scythe device without him expecting it.
Yeah, that last fight was pretty much the telling of that tale. You know, he went in with the BKB, thought he could snipe a support, but no. With the Beastmaster Roar now at 900 range, as well as the Shadow Demon Purge, he's not looking to get any kills. And this is essentially why Funnik stopped getting clinks for one, but for another, why it just kind of fell off as a whole. Its efficiency requires you to snowball extremely well. And with that said, Storm Spirit is kind of similar. Funnik's looking to make a snipe here, but he's not going to get a snipe on the Prophet. He might get a snipe on Syndra, however.
He could take Syndra and just confuse him when this fight begins, because there he goes. So opens up and Syndra instead. Syndra will pop from this Orchid. There is no doubt about that one. Even one extra right click. Now Denny going to chase down Koifa. He's the one to chase. The dust already popped off, pulling him back. He hasn't popped the Ghost Scepter. Just lets the Aegis of the Immortal actually trigger off on him. Black looks like he wants to turn around and try and help him, but Dexter is here. There's already one pickup. There's a follow-up stun. Mana Burn and Funnik just keeps damaging on him, and it's a double kill for Funnik.
I find it odd that he didn't pop his Ghost Scepter as he was running. What about you?
I think it was just looking to wait until after the Aegis the Immortal popped off, but
But when you use Aegis in that kind of situation in front of the enemy base, it's quite obvious that they're going to TP on you and they're going to use disables to lock you down. And Koipa, I know this guy. Like, he's smart enough to know that, yeah, if I use Ghost Scepter now, I can at least waste some of their spells. And then the downtime forces them to use either another Dust, or at the very least, I'll be more prepared. But regardless, he didn't use spells.
Oh, Fader. Lit off the roar, but now the Orchid's on him, and they are looking to attack Skywrath Mage. Got decent ultimate off just then, but not enough to finish anything. Maybe, yeah, any mage can. Mana Void picks off one, picks off two now, goes over towards Dexter. There's just so many blacks fighting in this, and now it's going to be, in fact, a triple kill for Black. Beastmaster got the kill on a Vorst, and Mousesports lose nothing. And they will take everything.
And they most certainly will, with the tier 2 tower at the mid lane being the start. About 30 to 40 seconds on the clock for their heroes that are dead right now. Dendi is the sole defender, but of course without his BKB he can't do anything. With his BKB he's only alive for 9 or however many seconds there are left. With the Anthem Mage as well as the Nature's Prophet ultimate, as well as the Nature's Prophet himself pushing all three lanes in, I don't know if Na'Vi can hold this. At best, they're gonna keep Mousesports out of their base for another couple of minutes, but the tower is going down for sure, and after the tower, eventually, there are going to be Raxes being pressured.
Roar on Dendi, he's out too far. He was just looking to poke and prod and thought he could jump himself away in time, but with an Aghanim Scepter up on Beastmaster, you can't poke and prod. He'll take you every time. So tier 3 tower lost on the mid as well as the bottom, and mid melee Rax does go down. There's an extra TP coming out. It's a four smack bang in the middle of the fight. He's instantly silenced by Sin. Very quick reflexes from him. And now Kuro jumps out. They can at least pick off one support. They're going for pass at the moment. And he will take a fall. Ghost Scepter slows him down. But Kuro says, well, I've got the magical ability. That's okay. Black gets Orchid on the bottom lane. So Denny will pull him back in again. So that Na'Vi are actually able to pick up too. But they still lost a hell of a lot.
Yeah, they did lose a lot for those pickoffs. Of course, while they were big pickoffs, at the same time, I mean, Black, he's sitting here with 4.4k gold, Toby. The Roche is going to come up in 5 minutes, and I'm sure if they really wanted to play a safe game, they would just wait for that. Not to mention the fact that Dendi getting picked off there completely lost some Raxes, because if Dendi was able to stay in, the pressure of a Storm Spirit jumping into the middle of the fight with a Lifestealer inside means that he could have probably saved Raxes, even if it was like 5 HP off, because... yeah, because they would have been able to take a fight inside their base. Everything was in their favor. They had the positioning. Nature's Prophet was not exactly ready because he's splitting off from somewhere else. But no, he got picked off by the Aghanim Scepter. Very well done by Fader, of course, but it did cost them Raxes.
Yeah. Well, the question right now is, can Mousesports actually go back in there and do that again? Like, Lifestealer, he's starting to find a little bit more farm up. Dendi, like, he's not looking amazing, but he should be looking at another mana pool item. Or at least his first item pull item, so he can keep jumping himself around and being that close to the base. Then again, I look over towards Fader and I see him with 3.4k gold. If he just picked, like, moves himself into an Assault Cuirass right now.
Yeah, pretty much.
They have Base Breaker. And Animage there with a BKB. There is not a single thing of Na'Vi that will go through that.
No. They can't lock him down at all.
Unless Kuro steals Roar, that's the only thing, the only possibility they have.
Speaking of which, has Roar been stolen this game?
I haven't seen it.
Wow, that's actually impressive. I keep talking about Kuroki and how he just steals spells all the time, but Beastmaster Roar is one of those spells that it's actually easier to steal than RP. Well, maybe not, but
it's
gonna get roared up.
BKB went off. They were using him as bait, and Black BKB'd himself up right now. But that BKB's gonna wear off in a moment. Funny, because his one's gonna wear off a little bit sooner. Havors being stunned up. He wants to infest. Look, walk towards that boar. He's gonna get himself out of this one. He never infested. Dexter was right next to him, but Dexter will go down. AM throws the ulti out. He was looking for a kill on Denny. Denny on very low life, and Havors already calls the GG. He realizes Denny will die outside. It was basically a bait. They needed the best team fight of their lives in order to get on top of that. But now it's going to be Mousesports going one game up here in the first game of the defense season 4.
Yeah, and Havos, he got silenced up there. He was unable to use any spells after the rage. Once again, that Skywrath Mage is coming into play for so many scenarios. A lot of these fights, Storm Spirit or the Lifestealer would get silenced, and it would just hinder their ability to stay inside the fight. And yeah, as we see other heroes going down now, it's just... it's too much. They lost way too much from the beginning, or rather, I gotta say, they didn't get enough at the beginning with the heroes that they picked. So, they certainly paid the price later on in the game.
Yeah, that they did. I love how the fact that Na'Vi is still playing around to the very, very end. But this is not the start that I was looking for on the defense. And this was definitely probably the hardest matchup as far as the seeded teams going into this group stage. Mousesports and Na'Vi were number one and number two. And this had to be their tough game. Of course, there is still the possibility that Na'Vi can force out the draw. This is a best of two. So, yeah. Or two games, depending on how you want to phrase it. But you can't have a
best. Will Puppy be ready?
Puppy should be back by now. Puppy should be back by now. I don't think, though, you could really say too much bad about, like, what came out from their stand-in. Like, it really wasn't that bad. Like,
There was
that one moment around the mid, which wasn't quite right, but... the synergy of the team can obviously be thrown out when you just remove one key factor.
That's right. Yeah, that's basically what it comes down to. Against Mousesports, who have demonstrated themselves so strong lately, and you know they're in their prime right now. Either they just won the qualifiers, they know they're going to TI3. They have to be like this is pretty much the highest point of their career in terms of emotions. Their spirits are all the way up. Whereas Na'Vi, you know, I think it's official that their move to China is going to happen soon.
Yes, it was announced, I believe, yesterday.
Yeah. So, with that said, they're probably going to be looking good. Unfortunately, what I wanted to get at is that, yeah, with the stand-in, it's always a little bit tough. So, let's hope for a better game, too.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it, man. Mousesports have been playing really good Dota. They deserve that win right now. Can they actually wrap it up and take the top spot in the first group? You'll find out. Stay tuned. We'll be back here for more of the defense.
I said good day, sir!